Now, I want to critique what's happened in the past year and a half in our nation, but to show you that I'm not partisan and this isn't a partisan politics, I want to share this story with you. So almost a year ago, in his final State of the Union, President Obama was speaking to a joint session of Congress. In his speech, he quoted the Constitution. He said, "We the people, we've come to acknowledge, we've come to understand that means all of us." Now that sounds beautiful, right? But I heard that and I'm like, really? I didn't get that memo. I didn't know we concluded we the people meant everyone. I mean, that seems to be the debate we had this last political election. Donald Trump had a very clear idea of who we the people included and didn't include. Did not include women, did not include Muslims, did not include immigrants from the South. He was quite clear on that. The challenge with Donald Trump is he understood what made America great, which is explicit and systemic racism. He wanted to champion that again. Not unfortunately, Hillary, though, was not his antithesis. So Donald said, "Make America great again." What did Hillary say? "America's great already. America's always been great. America's great because we're good." So what did they agree on? Our past, our foundations, our history is great. At the Democratic National Convention, Cory Booker, an African-American senator from New Jersey, he was on the platform endorsing Hillary Clinton for president. And in his speech, he referenced the word savages. He acknowledged the word savages in the Declaration. He acknowledged the exclusion of women and natives and the three-fifths compromise in the Constitution. But he bookended that section of his speech by saying, "Our founders are geniuses and our foundations are great." So, Corey, you can't say that. You can't say that unless your definition of great is racist. So the dialogue we had this last election cycle, it was not a racist, anti-racist dialogue. The question we had before us as U.S. citizens was, do we want Donald Trump to champion racism as our explicit value, or do we want Hillary Clinton to work to keep racism implicit? And the challenge is, since the civil rights movement, as a nation, we've grown very uncomfortable with explicit expressions of racism, but very comfortable with our implicit expressions of racism. Now, I did not expect Donald to win. I didn't expect him to win. I knew I was making this analysis 9 months ago. I didn't expect him to win. I didn't think our nation was going to vote to be explicitly racist. And technically, we didn't. He lost the popular vote by 2 million. But he won the election. So I was all prepared to critique a Hillary campaign, a Hillary president-elect. And I woke up at 2:30 in the morning on Wednesday morning last week and realized I have to change my critique. I had to speak at Wheaton College the very next day. And so I began thinking about, well, how do we do this? And the most troubling thing, I'm actually not surprised. I mean, I didn't expect him to win, but I'm not surprised. I mean, Donald Trump gets America. He knows what made us great, and he wants to bring that back. He gets America. What I'm troubled by is the white evangelical church supported Donald Trump by a margin of 81%. What I'm troubled by is the white Catholic church supported Donald Trump by 60%. How did this guy, who campaigned with such divisive, hurtful, even hateful rhetoric, get the white evangelical church behind him by amazingly high numbers? He's done better with the white vote than any Republican candidate in recent history. How did he do it? Well, he primarily campaigned to Christians. He had two primary messages. The first was he said he was pro-life. Now, I've been a pro-life advocate my entire life. You heard my pro-life critique of our Constitution. When I was in college, I gave a speech in a speech class about my pro-life values, and I got spit up and chewed up and spit out. Because I realized after that speech, I didn't know how to communicate my value for against abortion with an understanding of all the parties involved in this process are human. See, one of the things the doctrine of discovery does is it creates this mindset where we can create this category of other and place people there, and once we do that, we can treat them however we want. This is why America doesn't torture. It's not that we don't torture, it's that we believe terrorists aren't human. This is why the Christian church talks the way it does about the LGBT community. We put them in this category of other, and once we put them there, we can say whatever we want about them. Who is the most compassionate from the conservative Christian right towards the LGBT community? It's those who have members of that community in their immediate families. Why? Because they're no longer subhuman. That group has become humanized to them, and once they become humanized, you can't speak, you can't exclude, you can't talk to them that way. That's why Dick Cheney, one of the most conservative people in the Bush White House, was pro-gay marriage, because his daughter was gay. Once that category becomes human, you can't talk to them the same way. So this is what we do. We create this category of other and we put them there. And I realized I didn't know how to talk about my stance against abortion in a way that actually involved and embraced a comprehensive understanding of pro-life values. I didn't know how to articulate how I believed and what I felt without demonizing, otherizing, creating this category of less than of the people who performed abortions or had abortions or who supported abortion. And because I couldn't articulate that, and I looked at the pro-life movement and realized they weren't pro-life, they were pro-issue, I didn't say anything for almost 20 years. Because I didn't know how to articulate my values in an encompassing way that truly valued all life. Now, when I started studying the doctrine of discovery, I started looking at the Constitution, I started examining the 14th Amendment, I realized what we did. I finally found a critique of our nation's pro-life, our pro-choice stance that I could critique in a way that argued for the value of everybody's life. And I lay out that argument everywhere I go. Liberal, conservative, Christian, secular, everywhere I go, I lay out my pro-life argument. Now, I get a lot of pushback for the things I say. The Declaration of Independence doesn't say that. The Constitution doesn't say that. We are a Christian nation. I get pushback on a lot of things. No one has ever pushed back on my pro-life argument. I'm sure there's people who disagree, but I'm laying out such a comprehensive value for life that it's incredibly difficult to argue against it. Donald Trump is not pro-life. He's not. You cannot brand all Mexicans as rapists and murderers and be pro-life. You cannot brag about the fact that you got the first democratically elected black president of the United States of America to humiliate himself by publicly showing his birth certificate. You cannot brag that your fame and your wealth and your fortune gives you the right to sexually assault women and be pro-life. You can't do it. You cannot threaten to ban all Muslims from this nation and be pro-life. You can't have a campaign that excites the fringes like the KKK so much that they endorse you and even have a parade for you and be pro-life. You cannot do it. Donald Trump is not pro-life. And he played the white evangelical church like a fiddle. He got 81% of them to vote for him. Now, there's another thing about Donald Trump I want to go into. If you can play this video, there's like a minute video I want to show to you, and then we're going to talk about it.
Do you believe evangelicals are the ones, they kind of brought you to the dance, if you will, and they're the ones that are going to get you over the top here?
Well, we're doing very well with the evangelicals, mm-hmm. and if they vote, we're going to win the election, and we're going to have a great Supreme Court, and we're going to have religious liberty, because religious liberty, let's face it, I saw a high school football coach the other day, and they were praying before the game. You know, they're going into combat, they're in the locker room praying, and I think they're going to fire him. And, you know, they suspended him, I think they want to fire him. Who ever heard of a thing like this? And I always say to you, we're going to all be saying Merry Christmas again. But the truth is, religious liberty is under tremendous stress.
Religious liberty. It's one of the things Donald Trump campaigned on. This football coach that he's talking about, I don't know specifically which one he's addressing, but about a year ago, there was a football coach in Washington State. And after the game, he was going to the center field and beginning to pray. After the games, he would go to the center of the field and he would pray. Soon some of his players began joining him. And soon the whole team was there praying with him. After a while, the school said to him, you can't do that anymore. This is a public school. It's coercive. You may have players joining you at the center of the field praying with you, not because they believe in that prayer, but because they want more playing time. It's coercive. Now, do I think it's nice that he prayed? Yeah, it's nice. But I was reading this article and I found a quote by this coach. And in his quote, he said that he was fighting this stance by the school. And he said, I am a Christian who wears his faith on his sleeve. I am not a Christian who is going to go off and pray in the closet. Now, where does Jesus tell us to pray? In the closet. What does he say if we pray in public? I'm not going to listen to you. If you pray in public and make a show of it, you have your reward. I don't hear those prayers. So out of his commitment to religious liberty, our nation is fighting for the right to piously pray in public places in a way that absolutely ensures God is not going to hear us. What are we fighting for? What did Jesus say to his disciples? There's no religious liberty. You're going to be brought before judges. You're going to be persecuted. You're going to be put on trial. Stand firm, endure. He told his followers to go out and to lose their life for the least. To sacrifice themselves, to pick up their cross and show love for everyone. And the church in the United States, the white evangelical church in this election, we threw women, we threw Muslims, we threw immigrants under the bus. So that we could look a little more pious and feel a little more safe while we did so. The evangelical church has to make a decision. Do we believe Jesus or do we not? Do we follow a Lord who was crucified or do we not? We cannot continue to throw the least of these under the bus so that we feel a little more safe. We can't do it. We have to read passages like Luke 21 over and over again, and we have to decide, do we believe this? Is Jesus our Lord? Or are we merely Christians, citizens of a Christian empire? If Jesus is our Lord, we will embrace the hardships. We will fight for the rights of those around us. We will sacrifice ourselves and pour out our life. But if we are merely citizens of a Christian empire, we will create these categories of others. The poor, the migrant, the immigrants, women, minorities, other religions, and we will throw them under the bus so that we can retain our power and we can feel more safe. I fear, I lament, I mourn that if Jesus were to walk into many of our churches today, we wouldn't recognize him. And we would probably kick him out. Let me pray for us.